Water. Water is magic. We are attracted to water in all its forms. Running water is more than a material force, it is a spiritual element. Mountain paths always wind down to water. Pioneer settlers chose home sites according to the location and purity of springs. They were connoisseurs of water. Water was offered to guests as a sure token of hospitality. Long before the first Europeans arrived, the ancient Cherokees developed ceremonials focused upon the spiritual power of running water. In Cherokee ritual, the river is the long man, a giant with his head in some high mountain valley, his feet in the faraway ocean, pressing always, speaking ever in murmurs. Going to water for purification was a way of life, a part of every tribal function. Mention the French Broad, the Little Tennessee, the Catawba, the Savannah, most any of the larger river systems in the southeastern portion of the United States to the folks in New York or Chicago or Denver, and it's not likely you'll receive much of a response. Eyes will glaze over, heads may nod. But mention the much smaller Nantahala River, hidden away in western North Carolina, just south of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park, and it's likely that faces will light up with recognition. The whitewater industry, first established in the lower portion of the Nantahala River in the early 1970s, has made this river's name synonymous with outdoor adventure. But let's not forget that this lovely river, situated along a watershed rich and varied in regard to both natural and human history, can provide more than just whitewater-related experiences. From its headwaters near the Georgia state line to its confluence with Lake Fontana, it is a wonder world just waiting to be explored.
What a wonderful vista. We're looking from the Wayu Bald observation tower back to the south into the headwater system of the Nantahala River. You see the cloud system that's hovered in on the peak there? That's right at the back of the Standing Indian area, and the Nantahala River heads up right in that area and comes down through that water basin, passes under US 64, headed for Nantahala Lake. You see off to the right there, the highest mountain off to the right is Standing Indian Mountain, for which that headwater system is named. And now we're looking out to the west from the Wayu Bald Observation Tower. Out into that area just below the main crest of the Nantahala is where the river is flowing into Nantahala Lake. We can't see the lake from here, but it's down in there, and we'll be visiting it a little later on in our journey. Now we're looking off to the northwest down the main crest of the Nantahalas, where the Appalachian Trail runs. Looking to that area just out beyond those near mountain ranges where the upper gorge and the lower gorge of the Nantahala River are located. Off into the distance, you can see the Great Smokies looming, a massive range of Blue Mountains, the largest single mountain range in the eastern United States. And the Nantahala River is flowing down through the gorge there in between those mountain ranges, headed for Lake Fontana on its long journey from the Georgia-North Carolina line.
That's Lance Holland on the left with his friend George Ellison. For years, Lance was a backcountry guide and historian, which led him into a career as a location manager for motion pictures. His film credits include The Last of the Mohicans, The Fugitive, Nell, and My Fellow Americans. George is a writer who conducts natural history workshops throughout the eastern United States. He wrote the biographical introductions for the two classic studies of Southern Appalachian culture, Horace Kephart's Our Southern Highlanders and James Mooney's History, Myths, and Sacred Formulas of the Cherokees. On their own and together, Lance and George have been exploring backcountry regions throughout the southern Appalachians for many years. They'll tell you in a heartbeat that the Nantahala River is unsurpassed. They're taking off now to take a look at the entire watershed from its high origins along the Georgia-North Carolina state line to its confluence with Lake Fontana. Let's follow along.
I'm going across the mountains, oh, fare thee well. Going across the mountains, you can hear my banjo tell. Going across the mountains, oh, fare thee well. Going across the mountains, you can hear my banjo tell. I'm going across the mountains, oh, fare thee well. Going across the mountains, you can hear my banjo tell. Expect you miss me when I'm gone, but I'm a-going through. Going across the mountains, and I'll come back to you. Going across the mountains, oh, fare thee well. Going across the mountains, you can hear my banjo tell.
Okay, George, I think we found it.
That's really neat.
I think this would be the highest elevation source of groundwater that feeds Moody Branch that then feeds the Nantahala River.
Yep. Heading from about 5,000 feet here in the Nantahala River Basin, going down into the Nantahala River, the Little Tennessee River, the Tennessee River, the Ohio, the Mississippi, and this water starting out right here is eventually going to wind up in the Gulf of Mexico.
I know. Let's throw a stick in. I've got a cousin in New Orleans. We'll call her on the phone and see if she finds it when it gets there.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, you know something, George? I think a lot of people that at least that I take out, I don't know if you've had the same experience, aren't familiar with the phenomenon of water coming out of the ground like this.
It comes out sometime in a real spring head or sometimes a little seepage area or sometimes just a damp slope. And all of those different water heads are feeding in and making the little tributaries that make up the main streams that we call the rivers.
Right.
And the Nantahala River is just down the mountain slope here, down Moody Branch. Want to take off and see if we can find it?
Let's go.
Okay.
It's amazing that in such a short distance, that little stream of water that was coming out of that spring and then the little spring branch forms such a waterfall.
Yeah, it doesn't take much distance for it to pick up some real power, especially in this kind of area. And like the rainfall we had last night, you know, really increased it. And in this area of the Nantahalas, you can get as much as 90, 100 inches of rainfall a year, just as an average. In certain areas along here, they've measured as much as 140 inches of rainfall a year.
That's quite a bit of rainfall. I understand some people are starting to call this a temperate rainforest.
Yeah, the professional foresters, because of all the rainfall and all the rich vegetations, are calling it a temperate rainforest, and you can see why. And in this headwater system here, we've got all of these streams feeding in, little trickles, little springs here, little creeks feeding in here. Eventually, they'll join together on further down the mountain here in the Standing Indian area and become the Nantahala River.
Let's go see if we can find that. But first, we got to get out of here. Okay, George, I think we found it. Right here at the confluence of Moody Branch
and Laurel Branch.
And Laurel Branch is the start of the Nantahala River.
Yep, they're coming together here. The Nantahala will flow many, many miles before it'll finally empty into the Lake Fontana on its way to the Gulf of Mexico.
And I guess as it goes down through there, many more creeks will join in, making the river larger and larger
feeding
and larger.
Feeding into it out of the watershed, out of the big catchment basin here at the headwaters, flowing, getting large all the way down.
Right. Well, I have to tell you, this is, I guess, a good place to really get started on this thing.
This is the official start. This is the Nantahala River. Here, Lance, isn't that old railroad ties?
Yeah, they certainly are, and that's pretty rare to find a
railroad grade with ties on them. It's a lot of people are very interested to find out that so many of the trails in the southern Appalachians were built by the lumber companies to haul the logs out.
Originally railroad grades?
Originally a railroad grade.
And up this far on Mooney Creek?
This one probably went another 4 or 5 miles up Mooney Creek. This creek and this entire watershed up here was actually logged by W.M. Ritter Lumber Company, which was a company that also logged in the Smokies on Hazel Creek.
Hazel Creek.
And they had their lumber camp was up at the Standing Indian Campground, where we'll go to in a few minutes. Mm-hmm. And then they had a town and a band mill down by Rainbow Springs, sure, about where US 664 mm-hmm. intersects the road that comes up here to Standing Indian. Let's go on.
Well, here we are, Lance, 4 miles down the Nantahala River from the confluence of Mooney Branch and Laurel Creek. A little different setting here than it was up in that rhododendron and laurel thicket.
Yeah, here at Standing Indian Campground, it's quite open. You know, this area that's now a public campground was once the site of the main logging camp for W.M. Ritter Lumber Company. The sawmill was on down at Rainbow Springs, but the narrow gauge Heisler locomotives that operated on the tracks and the railroad grades, as we walked on a few minutes ago, brought the logs down and to the sawmill. And the sawmill, these were not small-time backwoods sawmill operations. These guys were the most advanced industrialists in the world. They processed their lumber through these giant band mills that were operated by electricity, fired by coal-burning electric generation mm-hmm. plants. They had dry kilns. Much of the lumber was made into hardwood flooring and mm-hmm. fine wood products. And Ritter was actually an international company. They had divisions in England and in Germany, both.
But now the setting's a whole lot different, with mainly, in this area at least, recreational. And you get your fishermen in here early in the spring when you get a trout run up from the lake up into this area.
Yeah, saw a lot of horseback trails as we came around, and hiking trails. Mm-hmm. I guess wildflower identification this time of year is a good one.
The slope's covered with trillium.
Sure. Well, you know, there was another pretty major commercial use for the Nantahala watershed just downstream from here.
One that's still ongoing.
Sure, mm-hmm. sure. It's pretty interesting stuff. So why don't we go check it out?
Okay.
You know, George, I bet a lot of the visitors that drive by Nantahala Lake here have no idea that this is used to generate electricity that serves a wide area.
Probably not. They probably just drive and see the beautiful setting here, and none of them either would realize that the old settlement of Aquone was located down in here, with lots of boarding houses and people living their daily lives, or that before that there were Cherokee people living in this area when they emerged as a culture about 1,000 years ago. And then the really neat thing that I like to think about is there were people living in this area 9,000 years or more before the Cherokees emerged as a culture.
Huh.
The early Paleo-Indian people, a few of those, and then the archaic people coming on down through the woodland times. So it's an area that's really gotten a lot of uses through the years, and now it's this sort of setting and facility, and that's the main dam over there, I think.
Right, and I think it's about time for us to head on over. Junior Johnson with the Nantahala Power Company is going to meet us there and tell us a little bit about how water makes electricity.
I've been looking forward to meeting and talking with Junior.
Great, let's go. Hello, Junior. It's good
Hi.
To see you.
Good, nice to see you.
Thank you very much for coming up. This is George Ellison.
Hey, nice to meet you, George.
Junior Johnson with Nantahala Power Company.
Great.
This is such a beautiful place. I'd like for you to tell us a little bit about, how the dam was built and how it all works and the power, the water gets down to the powerhouse.
Okay. the dam was built and finished in 1942, it was July 42. It's 250 feet high, 1,042 feet long, and we got the lake is 1,605 acres full. Got 107 million kilowatt hour storage in the lake with a full lake.
That sounds like a lot.
That's a lot.
So why would you build the lake up here at this high elevation and the powerhouse is way down there at the bottom?
Well, in order to get the head, of course, with the high head, we've got 1,008 feet of head, and that gives you a lot more energy. You've got, at the plant, you've got 435 pounds per square inch pressure. And the reason for that is that the higher the head is, the less water you use to generate the electricity.
All right. Well, I think we're going to go down and take a look at some of the penstocks that carry the water from here at the lake down to the powerhouse. I understand there's some little small vest pocket dams around. We want to see those, and then we'll go down to the main Nantahala powerhouse, and you can tell us how all that works.
Lance, let me see if I get this straight. This is one of the smallest of the four small vest pocket dams in the Nantahala system?
That's right, and these four small dams divert water from tributary streams and run them into the main penstock that takes the water to the Nantahala power plant. This particular one we're sitting on is the Diamond Valley Dam. It's about 6 feet high, 15 feet wide. The Nantahala power folks say if there is a dam that could be cute, this is it.
Wow.
And the only maintenance that's required for this dam is for the guys to come up and clean out this intake, and this dam produces enough electricity to run about 100 houses.
Just this one little unit.
Just
here.
One little thing. Right.
All
here.
Right.
Okay, Junior, this is quite a view of the operation from up here. Tell me a little bit about how this system works.
Of course, you've got one tunnel that's 8,900 and something feet to Dix Creek Crossing, and then we have 573 feet of pipeline. And then this tunnel to where it comes out of the mountain is where you can see the pipe coming out is 18,707 feet. And then coming on down the mountain, you have 1,075 feet of penstock into the turbine itself.
Okay, so that's about 6 miles of pipeline altogether. What does that big tank up there on top of the mountain do?
Okay, your tank is, that's a surge tank, and you have to have that in sudden stoppage of your unit. If you trip off the line, you got to have some way of stopping that water. And you got a small orifice down in the pipe or in the tunnel, and it just forces that water back up into the surge tank, and it basically rocks up and down in there until the water settles down.
In normal operation, is the level of the water in that surge tank the same as the level of the water in the lake?
It should be the level of the water in the lake. Close it. It may be a little different.
When was this powerhouse and dam constructed?
Well, it was started in 1929, and I'm not sure how long they worked, probably a year or two in the depression coming, and they had to stop work on a tunnel. And they started back work in about 39, and it was finished in July 1942, which put on the line.
So that was during the war. Was this electricity used for anything in the war effort?
It was used to, mainly what these were built for was to furnish power to the aluminum plant down at Alcoa, Tennessee.
To make aluminums for the airplanes.
For aircraft, right.
How much electricity does this plant put out? How is that measured?
Well, with a full lake, we can get about 48 megawatts. That's 48,000 kilowatt hours.
How many horsepower does this turbine and generator have?
You've got 60,000 horsepower turbine.
And the turbine turns a shaft that turns the generator.
That is correct.
The power on up. And so nowadays, where does this power go to?
Well, it's used in our system, in the Nantahala Power and Light Company system.
Mm-hmm.
Lance, welcome to the land of the noonday sun.
And I can see why they call it that.
Well, you know, in Cherokee, the word Natahala, that's what it means. And this time of the day, the sun starts to go away. But this upper gorge region is one of the most unique that I know of in the entire southern Appalachians. These high vertical cliffs with all the foliage hanging on them, the different rhododendrons and mosses and lichens and things, really do remind me of an oriental landscape.
They're quite unusual, even in a diverse area like the southern Appalachians.
Yeah, it's a setting that few people get into.
And you know, out of the 300,000 or so people that raft the Nantahala River, I bet 80% of them never come up here to enjoy this.
No, they're just a mile or two below us here, real close.
Right. Well, maybe we can encourage a few more folks to come up here and take advantage of this magnificent country.
I hope so. I hope they'll come up here and take a look-see.
Right.
Where are you all from?
Florida.
From Florida. Have you been here to float the Nantahala River before? Some of you? Have most of the young folks been with you before?
I'm the only one who hasn't done it.
Only one who hasn't done it, yeah. Well, it's going to be a neat time for you. Were any of you aware that this is one of the most unique geologic sites in the southeastern United States?
Yeah.
You weren't aware of that? Well, would you like to hear about it?
Well, we would, but we're kind of getting ready to head on down the river.
Well, maybe I can catch up with you later.
Sounds good.
Bye-bye.
Well, George, it's a little more quiet up here. That's quite a circus down there.
Yeah.
Well, how about telling me the story? I'd love to hear it.
You want to hear it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll make it as brief as I can.
Yeah, one of the most really dramatic geological occurrences in the creation of the Appalachians as we know them today were what the geologists call a river piracy or a stream capture.
Hmm.
And one of the most dramatic areas to observe that is right here at the Big Bend area of the Nantahala River, the raft put-in area where you have the river making a 90-degree turn.
Mm-hmm.
Arthur Keith, a geologist with the U.S. Geological Survey, came in here in 1907, and he said something strange happened here. He spotted the Big Bend in the river. He spotted that gap way up there. And he theorized correctly that the Nantahala River once flowed north as it does now from the Georgia line through the Standing Indian area, down through the Nantahala Lake area, through the Upper Gorge area where we were just exploring, and originally ran through that high gap up there, the Topton Gap.
And on down toward the Tallulah River Valley.
Tallulah River Valley, down through what the present-day Robbinsville area, mm-hmm. and went into the Little Tennessee. But a small stream eating back through the limestone area of the lower gorge actually captured and diverted the main river, causing it to rush back down through that gorge area, eating out and creating that really dramatic whitewater setting that we have today.
Mm-hmm.
So what you've got is a whitewater industry that is really formulated on some geological events that happened maybe 100 million years ago.
Well, and I guess that the limestone that was in that valley eroded very quickly.
Much quickly, and that allowed it to create that gorge-type setting and the Whitewater River setting.
Well, you know, just downstream from here at the Nantahala Talc and Limestone, yep. Company, the geologic skeleton of the Nantahala Gorge is there for us to see today.
Yeah, one of the most dramatic settings I know of in the whole Nantahala River system.
Let's go take a look.
Thank you.
The mine goes way back. No one really knows for sure. Probably back before the Civil War, coming in and using the sedimentary materials there. Some of it was marble-type materials, actually some pink-type marble that was mined and used in the courthouse in Raleigh when it was built, and then other materials for road building, and then it's called a talc mine because they can mine these soft materials called talc pencils that they can use in the high-intensity steel industries for marking. So the use of the mine goes way back, and it's really a part of the scene here and one that's quite interesting to me.
Well, we're here at the Percy B. Farabee Memorial on the Nantahala River, and Mr. Farabee purchased the mine in the early 1920s, I understand. Mm-hmm. He was a forester that came into the area in 1913, became very influential.
Became a businessman over in Andrews.
Right, he was the mayor of Andrews for many, many years. And of course, the quarry has been an ongoing concern ever since then. Mm-hmm. And then at his death, he bequeathed a considerable amount of land here in the gorge to the U.S. Forest Service.
Yeah, and they've taken over the administration of a good part of it.
Yeah, well, Sally Browning, I think, is going to come meet us here today and tell us maybe a little bit more about it.
Well, speak of the devil, that's Sally coming right there. Well, Sally, this is Lance Holland.
Nice to see you.
Good to see you again, Sally.
It's
been a while.
Have a seat. Well, Sally, we were just talking about Percy Farabee's contributions to the Nantahala Gorge. Do you know how much land and when he bequeathed it to the Forest Service?
Yeah, in February of 1973, 4,531 acres were transferred from the estate of Percy B. Farabee to the U.S. government. Uh-huh. And he wanted the people of all the United States to be able to enjoy the Nantahala Gorge, so that's why he put the Forest Service in charge of the acres.
Yeah, it's a unique setting that we've been exploring all up and down the river, Sally, telling the story of it as best we can, and now with your help. Down here in the lower part of the gorge is also interesting because of what happened geologically over in the Blowing Springs area.
Oh, yeah, Blowing Springs is a very unique area, and it's managed as a special interest area in the Nantahala-Pisgah Land and Resource Management Plan. It's a 190-acre area that's set aside to be managed for its natural conditions and to provide for environmental education and scientific study. Its uniqueness comes from the fact that it sits upon the Murphy Marble geologic formation.
Yeah.
And it has calcareous and dolmatic marble in it that forms soils that are slightly more alkaline
or
sweeter. Than the surrounding acidic soil, so you have these unique plant communities.
Mm-hmm.
And all that happens below 2,200 feet, and above 2,200 feet, the area goes back into the Brasstown Formation that's mm-hmm. composed of schists and metasilt stones and quartzites.
Yeah, and then on the north side of the highway here, you've got the river itself with all of its use down here in the lower gorge, and of course the Forest Service has a big role in taking care and monitoring the traffic along the river.
Yes, the Nantahala River has been under Forest Service management since 1983. In 1983, there were about 61,700 people that used the river with the commercial guides and outfitters. And in 1996, there were over 210,000.
So with that monitoring of the current use of the river, the Forest Service must be thinking down the line about somehow a master plan or some way of making this place usable on into the 21st century?
That's correct, because it's a big boom to the economy of Swain County and also to tourism in western North Carolina. And our management in the future will be based on the original Nantahala River Management Plan, mm-hmm. a river carrying capacity study that we did a couple years ago because of people's concerns about high use of the river, and also on the revision of the Nantahala-Pisgah Land and Resource Management Plan.
And speaking of the uses of the river, I just heard the steam train coming.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, want to explore a little bit around the area here and take a look at the setting?
Okay.
You know, George, the Nantahala Gorge has been a major transportation thoroughfare for literally thousands of years.
Yes, it really has, starting back with the early grazing animals, the buffaloes and others making the trails through here.
Yeah, and then, of course, the Indians would have followed those animal paths, following the path of least resistance on their way
to Tennessee, down the Little or up the Little Tennessee River to the towns in Georgia?
Exactly, crossing through here because that was the easiest pathway for them to get from east to west. And then as the early people came in from Europe, you had people like William Bartram, the famous plant collector, coming in from Charleston up the old Indian Trail and crossing right through the upper area of the Nantahala Gorge here.
Yeah, and that's where he ran into Attacoolacoola and his 30 mounted warriors and decided, well, maybe it's not time for me to go wandering in the back Indian country during the American Revolution.
Turned around, went back down the Indian Trail, back down, down to Charleston.
Sure. Then I guess the next big thing was the U.S. Army came in and built a road through the gorge to facilitate the removal of the Indians and the Trail of Tears.
Yeah, when the military came in, they put their major fort over at what we now know as Murphy, but it was called Fort Butler then. Mm-hmm. And they put out stockade roads all back through the mountains where the Indians were located to herd them up and to round them up and put them on the Trail of Tears to Oklahoma. One of those stockade roads also went right down through the gorge here, the line of least resistance, over to Fort Lindsay, near where the Almond Boat Dock is located now.
Right, and then I guess after the removal of the Cherokees, that opened up the area to early white settlements, so the roads would have been improved.
Town of Murphy established, the removal 1838, Town of Murphy established 1840, people coming in and living, and a few of them choosing to live here in the Nantahala Gorge.
And I guess one of the early settlers, particularly an activity-wise, would have been the quarry, which possibly was started before the Civil War.
Before the Civil War, no one's quite sure, and they would have had to build roads and thoroughfares to get the marble and other materials out of the quarry area.
Mm-hmm. And let's see, then after those early white settlers came in, then as things progressed after the Civil War, more and more people started moving in.
Yeah.
I guess the roads were improved.
Not too fancy, they were.
But they weren't, and in which, especially in bad weather, they were impassable. So there was a famine in the area in the late 1800s,
right,
which precipitated the state of North Carolina to construct the Smoky Mountain Railway.
Bring it through here, line of least resistance, the railroad coming through in the late 1880s, having a hard time getting up out of the gorge, but finally getting over to Murphy over the early 1890s.
And then as time progressed, more and more people moved in.
Into
modern highways became the thing of the day. Mm-hmm. And nowadays, the Nantahala River here is a major thoroughfare
for this. You got that thoroughfare, and then one of the really important ones is Appalachian Trail, which comes right through the gorge here a few miles below us. Probably a couple of thousand people traveling on it a year through the gorge area.
I understand that over 500 people a year walk the entire trail now.
Yeah, it's something that's quite common, and one of their goals is to get it here to the Nantahala Outdoor Center in that area where they can get reprovisioned.
Right. Well, you know, just downriver from here, there's a really unique transportation link.
I know, the very one you're thinking about.
Let's go look at
it. Yeah.
Quite a trip across that bridge.
We'll take a little break here.
Sure.
Yeah, these old bridges, about seven, eight of them still left in western part of North Carolina that are maintained by the Department of Transportation.
I guess quite a few school kids crossed a bridge like that on the way over to the highway to catch the school bus.
Early in the morning, and there was an old home site up the Nantahala River here on this side where the railroad tracks are. It's no longer there, but there are two neat Indian sites up here. There's a rock house site that may date back to the earliest Indians in the area, and then the so-called Indian cave, which is a neat site to get in and explore. Hmm. And we've got some Indian myths and legends associated with that site.
And we can look at the railroad as we go up a little bit.
Yeah,
let's go.
this is one of my favorite places, Lance. I used to bring my children here when they were little.
Yeah.
The so-called Indian caves.
Mm-hmm.
They get pretty excited about the site. Two rooms here. This is the larger room that we've come up into. Probably the site originally created when the river was up higher and washing mm-hmm. back into this.
Eroded back
yeah,
in.
Yeah, washing back in with the Nantahala Slate. We might like to think that the Indians chipped it out some, but and they may have a little bit, but not much. But
so would Indian people have lived in here actually, or
not really? Maybe on a hot day like it's getting today, as we get back in here, we get cool, and they would come back in here to get some relief. Or as they were hunting and fishing up and down the stream, they would stay over in this particular area.
Right.
Their idea about the origin of these caves is that they attributed them to the little people.
Mm-hmm.
You know about those folks?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. Anything that happened that you couldn't account for. A rock come rolling off the cliff in front of you, hear laughing off in the distance, diggings in the hills, like holes and things. Those were attributed to the little people.
I understand they were also credited for finding lost children out in the forest.
They were mostly benevolent spirits and took care of little children, but you always had to pay homage to them. So any hunters coming through here or fishermen with fish, if they were spending the night here at the Indian caves, according to one of the old legends, you had to leave some sort of gift for the little people.
Mm-hmm.
And there's one story that goes that a group of people came here and they forgot to do that. And they were sleeping over in the other room that we'll look at in a little bit. And late at night, they heard the ghosts dancing in this room.
Those were the
evil spirits of the little people. And that was the way that they got back at them.
I bet with the hole through the center of the cave here, that could be even scarier.
Yeah.
Let's look around at this a little bit. Okay, here we go through the hallway in our two-bedroom rock condo. I've come through here before when it was icy, and that's a great little ice slide right there.
Nice sight, especially
if it's really something.
Especially for young people come through the hole there. And over here, when I've got young people with me, I always have them look through this hole here. It looks almost like a window or some sort of area you would have a lookout from.
Okay, I can see some old-timers here using this as a sally port, I think they called it. Yeah.
I believe we're letting our imagination start to run away with us.
Well, we're getting pretty close to the end of the day.
Yeah, it's been a good day.
Oh, it sure has. But what if we head back down the tracks?
Yeah, let's do that. As a matter of fact, we need to go on into Bryson City. Back where I live, back on the other end of the county, we're going to catch the train over there and ride it back across Fontana Lake, back into the Nantahala River Gorge from that direction.
That should be a wonderful thing to do.
Yeah.
Let's go. Oh, look, George, I've been looking for one of these.
What you got?
This is called a clinker. I found this a little earlier. The old steam-fired locomotives that came down this track were fired by coal, and then after the coal was burnt, it became what they called a clinker.
Uh-huh.
And these clinkers quite often were ejected from the smokestack on the steam locomotive, and they were red hot.
Oh, boy.
So during the logging era, when you had all that slash and stuff around on the edges, what a good way to start a fire.
Good big old fire, yeah. Back in here in the gorge along the river, when they were bringing the railroad through from Asheville, they didn't have a lot of trouble until we got in here. And they had a lot of difficulty getting out of the western end of the gorge.
Mm-hmm.
They actually bought convict labor in here. And while they were working on the getting out of the gorge and building a trestle to get out, Hawk Nest Trestle, they would keep the convicts at night in those old caves that we were just in.
Yeah.
In fact, they had a preacher come in from Graham County, Reverend Wiggins.
Huh.
He'd come in and conduct the Sunday morning services for the convicts. But that was a long time ago.
Yeah.
We need to go check out what's going on now here with the railroad in the gorge.
I wonder if the convicts knew to pay homage to the little people when they were staying there. Hello, John.
Hey, Lance, good to see
nice
you today.
Nice to see you. Joan, this is George Ellison.
Joan, good to meet you.
Delighted to meet you.
I'm so glad you could come out and join us today. We want to know a little bit about the Smoky Mountain Railway since your organization has taken it over. I understand that you basically saved the day here.
Well, thank you very much for saying that, Lance. Actually, this started about 9 years ago, and this is our ninth season. I can hardly believe that.
Well.
Norfolk Southern was in the process of abandoning this line, and we just thought it was too pretty, too beautiful, too much history to lose. So we put together a corporation, including the shippers on the line, because we do run freight year-round still, and it's very important to this area to have that service. But primarily, it's so beautiful, and it brings in thousands of people who want to see the beauty and hear the history.
About how many riders per year do you have?
In the neighborhood of 180 to 200,000 people come ride with us every year.
And the Nantahala Gorge trip is the most popular.
Oh, it's a very popular trip, although our other trips also get a lot of interest. But it is a beautiful trip because you have so much activity on the river, all that rafting and kayaking and canoeing.
And passing over the lake to get out there as a bonus.
Yes, there is, yeah. There is quite a trestle that crosses a portion of Fontana Lake. It's almost 796 feet long. So you get an incredible view from that trestle bridge.
Well, from George and I's experience, the rebirth of the railway also sort of caused a rebirth of this part of Bryson City.
You're right about that, Lance.
This was a little ghost town down here, and now it's the busiest part of town.
It really has. It's amazed even me, and it's been very gratifying to see that effect.
Yeah.
Yes. How about coming with me today and taking a ride? We can give you a lift up to Nantahala if you'd like.
Great. Let's go.
That's where we're headed.
All right.
Okay.
For a location scout from Motion Pictures, the Great Smoky Mountain Railway is a wonderful thing to have in your backyard. The railway debuted in The Fugitive with Harrison Ford, and Lance will tell you from personal experience you've just never had fun till you've wrecked a freight train. Parts of My Fellow Americans, Digging to China, Paradise Falls, and numerous commercials have also been shot on the line. First proposed in 1845, while the area was in the grip of a devastating famine. Even though coastal North Carolina and the Tennessee Valley were enjoying bumper crops, the poor roads of the day did not allow timely transportation of the life-saving food into the mountain fastness. By 1859, area residents had pressured the North Carolina legislature to establish and subsidize a railroad from Salisbury on the North Carolina Railroad, passing through Asheville to the Tennessee state line near Murphy in Cherokee County. Delays caused by the Civil War and the monumental job of building the line up the mountain from Old Fort meant that the first train would not reach Asheville until 1879. Work began on the long-awaited Murphy branch in 1882. Progress was rapid until the construction crew reached the Nantahala Gorge. Extremely steep grades, pockets of oozing white mud, and incorrect surveys were encountered before the tracks were finally pushed through Red Marble Gap at the upper end of the gorge. The Western North Carolina Railroad reached Murphy in 1891, 32 years after construction began.
I think 17 miles an hour is just the perfect way to see the Nantahala Gorge.
Just my speed.
Right.
Payson Kennedy, an old friend of mine who founded the Outdoor Center here way back in 1972, is supposed to meet us over here near the river. So let's go see if we can catch up with him.
Let's do it.
Hey, Payson. It's a nice day to be out here with you.
On this
new bridge. I brought my family here in 72, just after you'd gotten the Outdoor Center set up, and I'm not sure I would have bet the farm that Whitewater would still be a going concern. Does it surprise you a little bit?
It has. When we came up here, it was to have a change of lifestyle where we could live on the river and in the mountains, get away from the city. Yeah. And we never expected there to be big numbers of people. We thought it would be a pretty small operation with just the people who really love to paddle.
And what's happened? It's become a generational thing, people teaching their children and grandchildren, and they keep coming?
They do keep coming. I'm not sure of all the reasons. It seems like outdoor sports in general have grown a lot during that period.
The river's known actually worldwide for the whitewater activities. People have been here from Russia and all over to take part in festivals and things, but since it got started, other activities have grown up. The biking and hiking and rock climbing and other things.
Yes, we've always thought of it as an outdoor center rather than a whitewater center because we do enjoy backpacking, we enjoy climbing. One of my favorite activities these days is biking. I love mountain biking and road biking. So these other activities have grown, and biking particularly now is becoming more and more important. And it helps out have some cooler weather activities that are popular as well as just the river activities.
But the whitewater's still right there at the heart of it.
Yeah, that's our biggest, most popular activity.
You know, George, just 100 yards downstream from all this activity here at the Nantahala Outdoor Center, the Nantahala River becomes tranquil again.
Well, that suits me, Lance. Let's go downstream a little ways and check it out.
Here we are, Lance. This is the end of it all. The Nantahala River coming over the Weser Falls there and emptying into the headwaters of Lake Fontana.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, it's been a long journey from the headwaters up at Mooney Branch.
It has, George, and it's been just an excellent trip. And the thing that I hope is that the people that see this documentary, next time they come to the Nantahala River, they'll get off the beaten track. Go back up the upper gorge, maybe to Standing Indian, search out those hidden things, because there's really some neat stuff around here
really
to see and do.
Lots and lots to do and lots of places to explore.
Great. Well, I'll tell you what, George, it's been a wonderful trip, and I know the perfect way to end it.
How's that?
Let's go for a boat ride.
Okay.
Water transformed. In our time, rivers have become lakes, energy sources, after Japan bombed Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, the federal government authorized the construction of Fontana Dam to create a giant hydroelectric facility on the Little Tennessee River to aid in the production of atomic energy. More than 6,000 workers came into the area, shifts working around the clock every day of the week. What was then the fourth largest dam in the world, 480 feet high, was in full operation by early 1945. Extending almost 30 miles back eastward into the mountains, the reservoir flooded the lower reaches of the Nantahala River, water into water, creating Fontana Lake, a thing of beauty in its own right, providing energy and recreation. But our everlasting fascination is with moving water, with creeks, streams, rivers, like the Nantahala, that call to us from their headwaters, that beckon us to come and explore their magic places.